Deo.
Non diligamus verbo, neque lingua.
sed opere et veritate.
Ah. Dominus vobiscum.
Et cum spiritus tuo.
Sequentia Sancti Evangelii secundum Ioannem.
Gloria tibi, Domine.
In illo tempore, dixi Iesus turbis Iudeorum, caro mea vere est cibus, et sanguis meus vere est potus. Qui manducat meam carnem, et bibit meam sanguinem, in me manet et ego in illo. Sicut misit me vivens pater, et ego vivo propter patrem. Et qui manducat me, in ipse vivet propter me, hic est pani, quae de cielo descendi. Non sicut manducaverunt patres vestri mana, et mortui sunt. Qui manducat hunc panem, vivet in aeternum.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
So the Catholic Daughters of the Americas are selling raffle tickets after Mass in the vestibule. Among the groups supported by the proceeds of the raffle are seminarians, priests and sisters, Catholic schools, Covenant House, Clare House, St. Teresa's Camp, and Beans Cafe. So please help support the Catholic Daughters in the works for the Archdiocese. Now, Tuesday evening at 7 p.m. in the Ministry Center, our summer catechism series continues. The topic for this week is the Incarnation. All are invited. Now, Friday is the Solemnity of the Sacred Heart of Jesus, and we will have adoration and hour reparation before the Blessed Sacrament from 7 to 8 p.m. Then Saturday, following the 9 a.m. Mass, there will be a rally in honor of the Feast of the Immaculate Heart of Mary outside with the rosary and a little fervorino. So we welcome those who are visiting us today and hope that your stay in Alaska is a blessing. Now, it's a little confusing when you have the old, different old calendars. If you look at your little worship aid, it'll say the second Sunday after Pentecost, although in the older Dominican calendar, this was also the Sunday within the octave of Corpus Christi. So things kind of flow from one to another. That's why we had the sequence today, and although the vestments are green, sort of ordinary time kind of thing again, still, we are within that octave. And our gospel today really is very Eucharistic-centered. So, in a sense then, let's talk about Corpus Christi, that feast we would have had Thursday in the Dominican Rite, and which we had today, especially with a procession in the morning, in the ordinary form. Well, in the early to mid-1800s, there was a curious practice that rose up in Victorian England. With the rise of industrial city centers and all the influxes of immigrants and poor from the rural areas, slums really began to fill up and arise in full force. Of course, this only exacerbated some existing class differences and social separation. And so what happened was, well, there came about some educational field trips of sorts that began among the upper class and then also the journalists and the clergy. A kind of educational tourism to the poor areas and to the slums. Now this would give those who went a certain kind of social currency among their at least emerging socially conscious society, and it could thus give them some import when speaking on the matters of social ills. A kind of proto-wokeness, if you will. So this practice was quickly called slumming. Rich Londoners even came to the United States to tour the sprawling emerging American city tenements and slums, as some tourists today might visit the favelas when they went to big city Brazil. Now, a few folks were inspired by these visits to launch true social reform and church welfare programs. But oftentimes, it just gave people the ability to show off to their peers. I mean, why bother going to see the so-called noble savages of the indigenous tribes across the oceans when you could just take a guided tour through a slum and be back home the same day? Now, all this with proper police escorts, of course. It did have some positive effects, but I think it tended really just to make the poor even seem more like the other to the rich. Because in these excursions, there was not really a human bridge. It was not a personal connection. This was not a communion of souls. This was more like an ephemeral encounter, almost like a visit to a zoo, really. In the early 1900s, the writer Upton Sinclair famously wrote a novel to expose the great crimes of wage slavery. But he instead ended up grossing out so many people about the process of sausage making that food safety laws were passed instead. As he said, I aimed at the public's heart, and by accident, I hit it in the stomach. So somehow, we never quite always got the message of these socially conscious trips and books. The church, in some ways, is not immune to this. There is always, in these things, a good intent or instinct in trying to connect with the poor or those on the margins, but oftentimes what happened was not so much as a personal conversion, but a confusion of various programs and policies that were not always very well thought out, even if well meant. Even liturgically, we have suffered under various kinds of dreams and illusions of the early church as a kind of noble savage, a place where everything was simple, poor, and true, but essentially ignoring almost all of St. Paul's letters as to the very modern problems that really arose right away among the supposedly simpler church. During the great societal revolutions and convulsions from the 1960s onward, in which the church was deeply embedded for good and for ill, a certain kind of spasm overtook us, to return to something pure without thinking, without, as the phrase says, any needless accretions, that is, additions that take away from the very heart and message of Christ. This is what the council wanted. Now, obviously, sometimes people get carried away, and these super excessive additions have to be trimmed, but what is love, I say, but needless accretions? Love is not about capitalist efficiency, as if we were trying to crank out Model T Ford masses. But mass is about a full giving of self, which is always a rather inefficient affair. The widow's mite is the definition of a needless accretion to the temple treasury. And certainly the sinful woman's bathing of Jesus' feet with expensive nard and her tears were, to modern sensibilities and to Judas alike, wasteful and not simple at all. Yet, even the whole cosmos today cries out as God's endlessly needless accretion, and to him it continues to give the glory. Now, I remember hearing firsthand stories from elderly priests about after the council, all the most precious vestments and many other sacred things were literally thrown into the dumpster without second thought. And then great expense was had in order to make sure that we looked properly poor with costly, new, simple vestments. Even monstrances were not always immune from the bin or the pawn shop. Now, ironically, perhaps the saint who would be most at home in the slums would be St. Francis of Assisi. And he famously railed against this idea. God help the poor Franciscan friar sacristan of his time who could not be bothered to have beautiful and elegant altar cloths, a clean church, even merely purificators in good condition. St. Clare herself embroidered many fine linens for Holy Mass. Dorothy Day herself, a modern saint of the slums with no guile or pretense, did not have much of a tolerance for such slumming nonsense in the Lord, or for showy hipness. A young priest once celebrated Mass for her group using a coffee cup for a chalice. She promptly and without a word took that very coffee cup and buried it after Mass, teaching the young priest a valuable lesson. Another time, someone gave her an expensive diamond ring for use for her ministry. And then, later encountering a somewhat surly poor lady, she gave her the ring instead, to the scandal of her companion. Her reply was, "Do you suppose that God created diamonds only for the rich?" What she and St. Francis and many others have figured out, in my opinion, thinking with the mind of Jesus, is that from our human vantage point, we should not discern between deserving and undeserving poor. That category doesn't really exist. We often want to give the poor only what we think that they need, never quite bothering trying to discover what they would like or actually need. Tamar, Dorothy Day's daughter, who lived with her among the poor as poor, once said of their humble home, "I don't care if we have no food, I am going to have flowers in my house." Those flowers were, by definition, needless accretions. But they were accretions that lifted up the spirit. The poor need beauty. They need a little needless accretion every once in a while, a connection to that which is true, good, and beautiful, that which points us upward. And here we are in our own days. Oftentimes we feel we are not a real church unless we are actively and liturgically slumming, feeling ecclesiastically woke as we participate in the Eucharist when we do so without any fanfare or elegance. So they would say that we are returning to the time before the Feast of Corpus Christi, when Eucharistic devotion was not so excessive, not so out of control. But why did this start in the first place? Well, the reason was that St. Juliana the Abbess, who lived a very poor life herself, very strict life of poverty, just before the time of St. Francis, inspired the church through her visions to institute this feast because precisely we were again slumming in the liturgy with hearts grown cold and the Eucharist made more simply some other thing than acknowledged as Jesus Christ, body, blood, soul, and divinity. She and a bishop friend wrote the first office for Corpus Christi, although that bishop died before it could really take hold, but it would inspire a slightly later Pope, Urban IV, to commission one, St. Thomas Aquinas, to write the Mass and office for this beautiful feast. To those who say, "Well, we never had this in the East. The Eastern Church never had to have this kind of feast." Well, I'd say maybe it's because they never slummed in their liturgy. And thus, they had no need for that correction. In our own days, we need to sort of re-stress this love for the Eucharist, as in the days of Saints Juliana, Francis, Claire, as in the days of St. Thomas Aquinas. When we got away from this love for the Eucharist, in all its glorious excesses of love from our Savior in making himself our daily bread, I think we began to see it more as a commodity than as an incredible grace and largesse from our Lord. Because before the Eucharist, we are all poor, though we do not want to admit it, and we are the ones who are really undeserving poor, perhaps the only truly undeserving poor, though we are often too proud in our own days to admit that. Perhaps this is why we have these contemporary scuffles over receiving communion. It is us not acknowledging in humility our all of us needing our Lord in the Eucharist, as much as in the Eucharist, we seem to want Jesus to publicly acknowledge us and our station in this world and to publicly validate us and our opinions. To paraphrase Upton Sinclair, we aimed at the hearts of believers with the Eucharist and somehow we struck the ego. The Eucharist is then this incredible nexus. It is two things that are in tension that cannot be separated or divorced without damaging how we look at the Eucharist. We have the sublime humility and condescension of Christ in this present form, with his heavenly majesty and glory in which we are drawn into to participate as a foretaste. the most basically simple food is at the same time the most august and exalted thing there could possibly be on this earth. Now, as a glorious monstrance draws our attention and focus toward the inward reality that is the Eucharist under the appearance of bread, so do the rays of glory shine out from its simple center and form. This is what St. Francis understood, I believe, when he often and repeatedly wrote so beautifully on the Eucharist, infinitely more often than about birds or trees, and far more than even about poverty. He understood that while we may be cheap with our devotion, Christ was not cheap in the Eucharist, holding back nothing of himself. Jesus does not go slumming to our lowly human condition, a little day visit, but he truly becomes one of us poor men and remains with us still even more humbly in the Eucharist. Now, to use St. Francis's own words, quote, "Let everyone be struck with fear, let the whole world tremble, and let the heavens exult when Christ, the Son of the living God, is present on the altar in the hands of a priest. O wonderful loftiness and stupendous dignity, O sublime humility, O humble sublimity, the Lord of the universe, God and the Son of God, so humbles himself that for our salvation he hides himself under an ordinary piece of bread." Brothers, look at the humility of God and pour out your hearts before him. Humble yourselves that you may be exalted by him. Hold nothing back of yourselves for yourselves, that he who gives himself totally to you may receive you totally. To that, all that we could possibly add is, blessed be Jesus Christ, in the holy sacrament of the altar, now and forever. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Credo in unum Deo.
Thank you.
Per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Dominus vobiscum.
Et nos spiritus tuo.
Sursum corda.
Et
gratia sagamus, Domino Deo nostro. Benedignum et justum est, ecum et salutare, nos tibi semper et ubique gratia sagere, Domine Sancte Pater Omnipotens Eterne Deus, qui cum unigenito Filio Tuo, Spiritus Sancto, unus est Deus, unus est Dominus, non in unius singularitate personae, sed in unius trinitate substantiae, quod enim de tua gloria revelante te credimus, hoc te filio tuo, hoc te spiritu sancto, sine differentia discretioni sentimus, ut in confessione vere sempiter neque deitatis, et in personis proprietas, et in essentia unitas, et in maestate adoretur et qualitas, quam laudant angeli atque arcangeli, cherubim quoque ac seraphim, qui non cessant clamare quotidie, una voce dicente. Sanctus, 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 Dominus Deus Sabaoth, pleni sunt celi et terra, gloria tua, Hosanna in excelsis, benedictus qui venit in nomine Domini.
Nobis quoque peccatoribus. Per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Oremus, preceti sanitaribus moniti, et divina institutione formati, audemus dicere, Pater noster, qui es in cieli, sanctificetur nomen tuum, adveniat regnum tuum, fiat voluntas tua, sicut in cielo et in terra. Panem nostrum quotidianum da nobis hodie, et dimite nobis debita nostra, sicut et nos dimitimus debitoribus nostris, et ne nos inducas in tentationem. Per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Pax Domini sit semper vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Agnus Dei, qui tollis peccata mundi, miserere nobis. Agnus Dei, qui tollis peccata mundi, miserere nobis. Agnus Dei, qui tollis peccata mundi. Grazie a Dio, per il Teo, se ti vita, voi vi sono cada vessera, libera vostra, un malo, sabre, confirme, in ogni opera bono, peruca vostra vita in terra. Absorzione, commissione, un peccatron, vestrom, triba, ovis, omnipotenza, misericordia.
Oh.
fuit mihi, et salam nomini Domini altissimi. Dominus vobiscum,
Dominus spiritus tuo,
oremus. Domtis muneribus sanctis quesimus Domine, ucum frequentationi misteri cresca nostre salutis effectu, per Dominum nostrum Iesum Christum filium tuum, qui tecum vivet regnat in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deo, in omnia saecula saeculorum.
Dominus vobiscum. Initium Sancti Evangelii secundum Ioannem. In principio erat verbum, et verbum erat apud Deum, et Deus erat verbum, hoc erat in principio apud Deum. Omnia per ipsum facta sunt, et sine ipso factum est nihil. Quod factum est, in ipso vita erat, et vita erat lux hominum. Et lux in tenebris lucet, et tenebrae eam non comprenderunt. Fuit homo missus a Deo, cui nomen erat Ioannes. Hic venit in testimonium, ut testimonium periveret lumine, ut omnes credent per illum. Non erat ille lux, sed ut testimonium periveret lumine. Erat lux vera, quae illuminat omnem hominem venientem in huc mundum. In mundo erat, et mundus per ipsum factus est, et mundus eum non cognovit. In propria venit, et sui eum non receperunt. Hoc oratem receperunt eum dere Deis potestatem filios Dei fieri, his qui credunt in nomine eius, qui non ex sanguinibus, neque ex voluntate carnis, neque ex voluntate viri, sed ex Deo nati sunt. Et verbum caro factum est. Et habitabit in nobis, et vidimus gloriam eius, gloriam quasi unigeniti a Patre, plenum gratiae veritatis.